What's going on, guys? This is Rob, and if you're enjoying the content here on my channel, then make sure you hit the like button and make sure you hit subscribe so you can help decide what direction the content on my channel goes in the foreseeable future. Okay, so you guys had to know this was coming. Like, you had to know that we were going to do a video about Deadpool in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Now, the big question that I imagine a lot of people are asking is, how would we do Deadpool in the Marvel Cinematic Universe? Would we basically just reboot him more or less? Would we just kind of continue things on? In all honesty, I would continue things on, to be quite frank. I mean, Ryan Reynolds as Deadpool just fits. It's like the Hugh Jackman effect. I can't see anybody else playing the role of Deadpool besides Ryan Reynolds. And I say that as a compliment. Ryan Reynolds is a fantastic actor. He's done a lot of comedies, different things like that, but Deadpool really seems to be his bread and butter, and you can tell how much he loves a Deadpool character because it really shines through in terms of how he portrays him. And it paid off. You know, we got a Deadpool movie, and it was a massive film. It almost broke $1 billion, the highest grossing R-rated film to date. But with, you know, Bob Iger and company at Disney basically saying, hey, look, there's room for a rated R film because it made so much money, we got to keep this party bus going, right? I mean, we can't stop. We got to keep this thing going all night long. And so in my mind, if we're going to bring Deadpool into the Marvel Cinematic Universe, we don't go through any of the steps that we went through with like the X-Men or the Fantastic Four. We don't conjure up this, you know, either simplified or somewhat convoluted origin, whichever one we choose to pick. We basically just have him there. He's just there. You know, Deadpool just there all of a sudden. And Deadpool becomes the voice of the fans. Deadpool's like, well, last thing I knew, I was owned by Fox. Like, I guess I'm owned by Disney now. And literally just goes through. And the reason why is because the first Deadpool movie in the Marvel Cinematic Universe would be hilarious. It would be this movie where Deadpool basically tours the MCU. For those of you guys who are new to Deadpool as a character in the comics, Deadpool is largely the voice of the fans. And it wasn't originally like that. A little bit of history here. Marvel and even DC and other publishers, Valiant, things like that, they have what are called eras. Publishing eras. And those publishing eras are usually marked by like paradigm shifts in publishing style. So let's say, for example, you were to take like the Golden Age. The Golden Age was the establishment of superheroes. It was the introduction of the superhero comic book genre to the world as a whole. 1950s, when World War II dropped off, we basically got what was called the Silver Age, or the Second Age, if you want to call it that. That was the transition from having just strict superhero stories to blending superheroes in science fiction. Following that, you just kind of had this mishmash. The Silver Age ran really through like the 60s into the early 70s, you had the death of Gwen Stacy, where Spider-Man failed to save his main love interest. That set the stage for the Bronze Age, more or less, basically the Dark Knight Returns era of storytelling, where things were really, really dark. But there were a lot of things that happened in between. For Marvel Comics, really, the big thing that kind of set it all off, that set off the idea of them crafting darker stories that were high octane, fast paced, different things like that, that all really came out of two main things. The first was in 1977 when it came to the Star Wars line of stories, and the second was in 1982. With G.I. Joe. With Star Wars, that was, of course, rooted in the huge success of the Star Wars film and the idea that it was going to be massive. People weren't 100% sure it was going to be massive, which is why the idea was to publish a line of stories that would basically help to, you know, build up the popularity of Star Wars. But because of the success of Star Wars, Marvel had established that there was basically room here for them to begin publishing comics that did not explicitly detail the exploits of their own creations, which is to say, comic books outside of Spider-Man and Captain America and Thor and Iron Man. So in 1982, under Tom DeFalco, who would later on become editor-in-chief in 1987, what Marvel did is they secured a deal from Hasbro to publish G.I. Joe. And it was a huge deal because G.I. Joe's comics went back a couple decades or so. But G.I. Joe had always been a World War II era line of comic book publications. The idea of Hasbro was to basically move away from World War II, which had long since been a non-popular concept when it came to publishing comic books, publishing, you know, any kind of super escapades, you know, comic book escapades. And so the result is that they basically got with Tom DeFalco and they wanted to move G.I. Joe to the modern era. But the reason why that matters is because the success of G.I. Joe under Marvel, which ran until 1994 for about 155 issues, it was huge because it basically meant that there was room to create stories that were not just, you know, more technologically advanced in terms of how the characters were depicted, but could be a little bit darker, could be far more action-packed, and could be super high-octane. And so what ended up happening is in 1987, after Jim Shooter left as editor-in-chief to form Valiant Comics and Tom DeFalco took up the mantle, Tom DeFalco ushered in this huge era of just super fast-paced stories where there's just 1,000 things happening all the time. But the character of Deadpool was designed to be part and parcel to that. One of the big mistakes that people make is looking at the character of Deadpool as he exists now and believing he had always been that way. That was never the case. Deadpool in his original appearance in New Mutants issue number 98, he was a plot device. You had Cable's son who had basically traveled to the modern day. He'd orchestrated a series of events in order to try to take down his dad. One of those events involved a character named Vanessa Carlisle, also known as Copycat. This led to Deadpool being contracted by Mr. Tolliver to figure out what was going on with Copycat. Copycat had fallen in love with Cable. There were all these intertwining themes that had gone on, but Deadpool was just an assassin for hire. That's it. But because of the fact that there were these sort of allures and teases to the possibility that Deadpool may or may not have had something to do with Weapon X, this bolstered a pretty good amount of popularity for his character because Wolverine was still riding high. The problem with this was that Wolverine was still highly enigmatic in terms of his whole origin and his whole backstory. And so the whole basis behind this was that people looked at the character of Deadpool as someone who could shine some light on the origin of Wolverine. And so popularity began to beef up a bit. And so by the time we got into like the mid-1990s, the comic bust. Basically what you had is you had Deadpool kind of free-floating in the Marvel landscape, that he would pop up in stories here and there. He fought Wolverine. He had a miniseries called The Circle Chase by Mark Waid, and all this ran into 1997. And the reason why that matters is because in 1997, the Deadpool line of comics were picked up by Joe Kelly. Now, one thing to keep in mind is in light of the comic bust, Marvel had no financial backing initially. If Marvel went bankrupt, there'd be nobody to save them. We would not see Spider-Man. We wouldn't see any more Captain America stories. A lot of people seem to really underestimate how close Marvel was to completely and totally going under. But the whole idea behind this was that because so many characters were getting the chopping block, they were basically being kicked off, because of the fact that so many characters could have their stories canceled, Joe Kelly and Ed McGuinness didn't really care what they did with Deadpool. They just wrote stories. And the whole idea behind this was that where a lot of the comics coming out of Marvel at the time were really high octane, they were, you know, technologically advanced in terms of how the characters were depicted, wearing headsets, things like that. What you had over here was Deadpool, who was just kind of funny. And that was really about it. Now, with issue number 33, the Deadpool publication was handed over to Christopher Priest. The funny thing about this is that because Christopher Priest knew that Deadpool was going to be canceled, he did the same thing Joe Kelly did. The difference is he amped it all up. He made it even, you know, like 100 times more insane than it was before. And so not only did you see him grabbing things like, you know, the old She-Hulk comics where, you know, you'd have Deadpool breaking the fourth wall on the cover of the story, but you'd also have Deadpool breaking the fourth wall within the story. This combined with the Joe Kelly invention of giving people a recap of what had happened in the comics before, suddenly he exploded into popularity. People could go and buy a random Deadpool comic. They could buy issue number, you know, 41 with no idea what had happened before. And at the very first, you know, one or two pages of the story would be a recap of everything you missed. And so they were caught up in the blink of an eye, jumped into the comic, and they felt like they were part and parcel to the whole Deadpool community. Now, following Christopher Priest's run, which only lasted maybe, you know, 11 or 12 issues, the title was handed over to a series of subsequent writers, Gail Simone, different people like that, none of which were really able to sort of hit the same kind of notes that like Christopher Priest and Joe Kelly had been able to pull off. This combined with the fact that not a lot of the artists were great meant that the Deadpool comic just kind of started to flounder a little bit. But the popularity of Deadpool among his cult following was enough to keep the comic afloat. And by that point in time, Marvel was for the most part pretty solid in terms of being out of bankruptcy. They were really actually getting into the early stages of forming the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And so because of that, over the years, Deadpool has seen a pretty good expansion to his character's publication history, and even to the character himself, which is to say, we've had all these different people play pretty huge roles in terms of expanding the Deadpool mythos. But that's kind of a quick little explanation in terms of why Deadpool's popular at the moment, you know, why he is the way he is right now in terms of the publication history. But getting back into, you know, the whole MCU thing, which is kind of why we're here, because of the fact that the first Deadpool film would be more of a tour of the MCU, which is to say, Deadpool being the person that answers the question for the fans, here's how the X-Men and the Fantastic Four and the Avengers and all the established superheroes reside within one another, it would also be sort of consolidating their origin stories, and Deadpool would remain the voice of the fan. You would basically have, you know, Deadpool depicted the way he was by Ryan Reynolds in the first movie, but then it would be things like, well, you're not the Colossus from my movies, you know, and they would be like, well, what are you talking about? He's like, well, don't worry about it, you know, it's nothing you need to worry about. You know, you'd see him encounter the new Wolverine, which I would hope would be Tom Hardy, and it would be like, so what happened to Hugh Jackman? I mean, it would just be different things like that. Like, it would just be these small moments where it would be obvious from the film that Deadpool is aware he's in a film. Now, it doesn't need to be on the nose. You don't want the comedy to be so on the nose to the viewer that it almost seems like you're holding their hand and walking them through all these little things. It's going to have, you know, a little bit of ambiguity there. It's going to have a little bit of anonymity, so to speak, in terms of leaving things a bit ambiguous. But you would walk out with a good understanding of how everything resides, because Deadpool would be sort of the anchor. He would be you in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, making things easier for you to understand, cracking jokes about people, different things like that. Now, from there, this is where we start to transition into Deadpool with regards to the role he plays, beyond being kind of an introductory form for the MCU with all the X-Men and Fantastic Four. What we would do is we would grab the character of Deadpool and we would use him as a means to introduce other characters who wouldn't necessarily have a reason to be introduced in the Avengers, but who are pretty interesting in and of themselves and could be evolved outside of the Deadpool comics. The next movie we do is we would just do Deadpool versus Taskmaster or Deadpool whatever, but it would involve the character of Taskmaster. Now, for those of you guys who don't know, Taskmaster is a guy named Tony Masters. And Tony Masters, he originally made his appearance back in like Avengers number 295 or something like that, 1980, I don't know. It's been a long time, but he's been around for quite some time. He's been around since like 1980. But Taskmaster is a guy who had essentially underwent the Nazi equivalent of the Super Soldier program. The difference here is that he came out, unlike Captain America, who just had enhanced, you know, speed, strength, and agility, you know, comparable to what the most athletically fit human would have. Taskmaster actually had the ability to memorize the moves of people, regardless of what those moves were or how complex they were. So he could literally watch a martial arts master perform a demonstration and immediately know how to perform that martial art. And he would remember it forever. Not only that, because Taskmaster is so prodigious in his fighting, he is largely considered to be the best fighter in the entirety of Marvel Comics. Now, the reason why I pick somebody like Taskmaster is because we've seen Ajax. We don't need to bring Ajax back. If we're treating, you know, that the first Deadpool movie as if it did actually happen, and we're just kind of rolling it into the MCU and we're not offering any real explanation, we're just saying, yep, it happened and it's there. And part of the Deadpool jokes is why it is that Disney didn't reboot him like they rebooted everybody else. The whole idea behind this is we have to emphasize the nature of Deadpool as a character. In Marvel Comics, you have two types of characters. You basically have the big time, you know, glitz and glamour Hollywood stars characters, and then you have the street level guys. Spider-Man, for the most part, is a street level guy. Spider-Man is comparable to like Luke Cage, Jessica Jones, Daredevil in terms of the role he plays. The difference is that because he's so popular outside of his own comics, when it comes to him being an Avenger, things like that, you'll see him with the Avengers off in various missions in different capacities that you wouldn't normally see him in. But the best way to determine what role a character plays is to look at their own comic books. And Spider-Man is a street-level hero. He fights street-level villains. Despite how smart they may be, how capable they may be, at the end of the day, you're not going to see Spider-Man racing off to the far edges of space to fight Thanos in some battle somewhere that's just one-on-one between the two of them. And so because of that, Deadpool is much the same way. And we have to celebrate that. We don't want to shy away from that because it's the cornerstone of his character. Because of the fact that Deadpool is literally just a mercenary that people hire to carry out different goals. And he loves chimichangas, and he's banged some super hot chicks despite looking all weird and stuff. You know, because of those things, we have to sort of bring that into the fold. Taskmaster is by no means a villain who could one-on-one take out every single one of the Avengers. Thor would destroy him. The Incredible Hulk would crush him. Captain America would probably get beat. Iron Man wouldn't stand a chance because he's not a real fighter. But Taskmaster is prodigious when it comes to organizing forces, military strategy, and tactics. He could easily be a mastermind behind the scenes who makes life absolute hell for the Avengers when he starts sending this group and that group and that group and that group. You could easily take the circumstances surrounding something like Days of Vengeance, for example, when Loki gathered all the Earth supervillains together and had them face off against various heroes, switching them around and adjusting them, you could actually grab that whole concept, remove Loki from the equation, and put Taskmaster in its place, and it works. Not only that, you could grab small things and you could roll them in. For example, in Marvel Comics, Taskmaster was the one who trained Crossbones how to fight, and you can grab that and you could throw it into the MCU. But from there, you basically move on and continue the trend of Deadpool meeting these street-level heroes, grabbing these street-level heroes, and rolling them over into the film universe. And I think that we can all agree it's high time that members of the Netflix series finally get their silver screen debut. And so in the next Deadpool film, it would just be Deadpool and the Defenders. Now, it could very well be that Deadpool shows up and maybe he's just kind of like an antagonist or something like that, something along those lines. But it's grabbing Luke Cage, it's grabbing Jessica Jones, it's grabbing Daredevil, it's grabbing Iron Fist, and it's bringing them onto the silver screen and having them team up against Deadpool. You could even grab just the Punisher and you could have Deadpool versus the Punisher. But there's a lot of things that you could do with that. But from there, you basically go on to what I would do in the final film, which is only the fourth movie, which would simply be Deadpool forms the Mercs for Money. That would be it. Deadpool forms his own version of Heroes for Hire. Heroes for Hire was a concept that was originally designed to revolve around Power Man and Iron Fist. And a lot of that was because of the fact that where Iron Fist was rooted in the era of Kung Fu, which is to say, you know, where you had white American guys who were wanting to be martial arts masters, it grabbed that whole ideology and it threw it onto Danny Rand. With Power Man, he was rooted in blaxploitation. The idea that there was a segment of Hollywood that was effectively for us, by us, more or less, where it was movies that were directed by African-Americans, they starred African-Americans, they were produced by African-Americans. It was strictly an African-American production in terms of the movie as it was made in Hollywood. Blackula is probably one of the best examples of blaxploitation. I love Blackula. Dude, Blackula. I love Blackula, dude. That movie is amazing. But, you know, because of the fact that those two characters were rooted in an era, a pop culture trend that simply faded, then what it meant was that by the time that went away, Power Man and Iron Fist just didn't really have anything going for. So Marvel grabbed the two characters, brought them together under Mary Jo Duffy, and had her write Power Man and Iron Fist, Heroes for Hire. And so because of that, they formed their own little organization called Heroes for Hire. And basically, if you can afford them, then they'll carry out whatever mission it is, as long as it's not killing people. This went on for years and years and years, ran for about 125 issues, but it is one of those groups that just kind of has like a hallmark name in the realm of Marvel. Under Deadpool, he did the exact same thing. He grabbed the Mercs for Money concept and then just rolled it over and just said, hey, so like we have these people who are basically going to dress up like me. We're going to be Mercs for Money. Now, the problem with this, and one of the reasons why this may or may not work, is because it resides on previously existing characters. It resides on characters like, you know, Slapstick and Solo and Fool Killer, different things like that. We don't have to grab that. We can just say it's just a bunch of crazy people who think Deadpool's like the greatest guy ever, basically Deadpool fans, and then they become the Mercs for Money or whatever it is. The problem is they never get jobs. Nobody ever wants to hire them. There's a bunch of funny things that you can do with that, where you can say, well, Deadpool's too ridiculous. Those are the kind of things that you can grab and throw into the MCU. Now, one of the things you guys will notice here is the Deadpool, like my vision for Deadpool in the Marvel Cinematic Universe is not nearly as complex as my vision for the X-Men and my vision for the Fantastic Four. And the reason for that is because in Marvel, when it comes to Deadpool, really kind of the way he exists in terms of great storytelling, which is to say the kind of stories you see now, much like the concept of the Mercs for Money, it's all predicated on all the development that has gone on with him over the years. In Original Sin, he learned he had a daughter, he's got all these different friends, but they have all basically evolved over the course of his publication history. So we can't treat Deadpool 1 as it happened and then roll Deadpool 1 and Deadpool 2 into the MCU and then say, well, now we kind of get to go ahead and jump into those things. You know, we can't just suddenly start spawning all these characters with no real explanation of who they are or where they come from. We have to build to that. Not only that, if we're going to have Deadpool in the MCU, we also need to establish that Deadpool is just as much a part of the MCU as everything else, which is why I would say Deadpool should have 7 movies that he's going to be in. We've got 4 of them listed here. The other remaining 3 are things like where he appears in other people's movies, teams up with Spider-Man in the Spider-Man movie. He shows up and he hounds the X-Men because he wants to join the X-Men. He won't leave him alone. Or they put him through a trial and it's just disastrous. Regardless of what the circumstance is, Deadpool appears in other people's movies and it's not a cameo. He's in there and he's in there for a good chunk of time. He might as well be a co-star for the film because of the role he plays. To me, that's kind of what needs to happen, because in Marvel Comics, Deadpool, his comics are funny when it's just him. He's even funnier when it's alongside other people. For example, you know, Deadpool was never an X-Man. It took like 10 or 11 years for him to become an X-Man. When he did, it was basically the character of Domino, the once enemy that he had fought against, the girlfriend of Cable, who had shown up at the request of Cyclops and said, look, we'd like you to join the X-Men. We're going to keep you on a short leash. Initially, the way this whole thing transpired, they were on a rooftop. Deadpool told her to back up. She took like 2 steps back. He shot the glass out under her feet and she landed on 372,000 pancakes that he'd somehow managed to make that morning. How you make 372,000 pancakes in one morning, I have no idea. But that goofy nature is what made that hilarious. His interactions with other characters. I would love nothing more than to see like Deadpool kills the Marvel Universe. I would love to see stories where he teamed up with Captain America and Wolverine in Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. I'd love to see Wade Wilson's War. I'd love to see those kind of things, you know, take place with regards to his character. But we have to build into it. We have to give people a reason for why these relationships exist. We can't have Deadpool and Wolverine and Captain America team up and have this sort of buddy cop film if Captain America doesn't know who Deadpool is. And so because of that, we have to sort of ease him in. We have to ease into all those different things. So that's why in Phase 2, that's when we would start seeing a lot of those stories taking place. That's when we would start seeing a lot of that expansion with regards to Deadpool teaming up more consistently and a lot of the stories that we're the most familiar with. Now, here's the other thing too, and I'm going to throw this out there. Deadpool kills the Marvel Universe. In all honesty, I could definitely see us doing that. I could see it being a dream sequence. I could see it being an entire film that takes place in the mind of Deadpool. And literally, the movie just kind of kicks off with Deadpool talking to Captain America, and Captain America's just boring him. And he just kind of, his mind just kind of starts to wander off, and the whole plot of Deadpool kills the Marvel Universe happens. I could easily see that taking place. You know, and at the end of the movie, you know, you basically just kind of pan back, and Steve Rogers is like, dude, wait, are you listening to me? And he's like, oh, I'm sorry, I was just thinking about something. And the movie ends. And that's it. That kind of goofiness, that kind of silliness, that kind of thing, I think, is what would make Deadpool pretty interesting in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. That's just an idea. But again, let me know what you guys think down below, because I know Deadpool can be really polarizing. And Deadpool's very difficult to do when it comes to rolling him into the MCU, because there's been so many different eras of storytelling for his character. He's been more or less soft rebooted, where everything that happened before has just kind of been wiped out, where past parts of his life have been ignored. His origin has been retold time and time again. It's very interesting when it comes to him, and it's very difficult to kind of roll him in and to make it all make sense. But let me know what you guys think down in the comment section. We're going to bring this video to an end. If you are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the sub button to become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure you drop a like, and I will catch you all later. Peace.